The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left their boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of the Lord. So following up a little bit on what I was talking about last week, and as a vocation director, because we're all of us priests are called to be vocation directors, I'm going to ask this crowd this weekend, how many people here today are definitely called to become priests? One, two, both of them ladies. I'm never going to fill my quota this way, you realize. Well, so I'm not going to talk about that. Instead, I'm going to talk about this. How many people here have ever given blood? Oh, yeah, we got a really holy crowd here. Get it? Holy, get it? Holy, holy. Nah, never mind. I know it's not a very good joke. I suppose it's a good thing to do, giving blood, right? It's in you to give. That's the slogan. Personally, I think it's good to keep it right where it is. Thank you very much. I'm not in any hurry to give blood. The closest I ever came to giving blood was in the 12th grade. Grade 12, you see, is a big year. Some of the kids turn 18, right? Big time for decisions. And of course, I had a big decision to make in my life, too. I was torn between three big possibilities. Possibility number one, I was going to become a cartoonist. That's right. I was going to draw my cartoons, my stories, my characters. All of them were catfish. Their adventures would be made into movies by Pixar. I'd become rich and famous. And finally, I would be married to Alyssa Milano. You're not supposed to be laughing at that. This was going to happen, okay? That was possibility number one. Possibility number two was that I was going to become a physicist, finding ways to control fusion and exceed the speed of light and get a Nobel Prize, all that cool Star Trek-y stuff, and then I'd make millions of dollars, and then I would be married to Alyssa Milano, yes. You're seeing the pattern here, okay, good. And the option number three was priest, just as something to fall back on, basically. Anyway, in high school, I was very good in physics. I was a top physics student. I'd get 98% on all my quizzes and exams. Usually I missed 2% because I forgot to carry the negative or I spelled my name wrong or something like that. You know, everything else was 100%. I understood it completely. In grade 11, we had to write a physics paper on something of our, whatever we wanted to. Most of the students were writing papers on how to turn on their stereos. I wrote mine on Einstein's theory of relativity, okay? So that's just to give you an idea. I was a smart student, and I'm not saying this to brag either. It was just a reality. I was good at physics. Just this gawky little 18-year-old with messy hair, those great big huge framed metal glasses that they used to have back in the 80s, you know? Under my yearbook photo, it says, "Most likely to either take over the world or become a movie critic." Everyone thought I was some mad scientist type genius, star physics student, much to the irritation of my physics teacher, Mr. Brent McDonough. Mr. McDonough, he was a smart guy himself. He had an advanced degree in physics, too. He was clean cut, dressed very well, very close shaven, hair just perfect, kind of the opposite of me, if you can kind of picture it. He always had those really nice expensive shirts, you know, and a beautifully done tie there. And he had this loud, kind of obnoxious voice that he'd teach us his physics. F equals ma. You got that? A force. A force is a force. Of course, of course. And he'd drill these things into us in our classes. Now, E equals mc squared. Have you got that? Everybody, have you got it? Right, right. Very smart guy. So he used to get so mad at me when I corrected him in class, which I therefore did every chance I could. Mr. McDonough would be teaching, okay, we got da-da-da-da, we put this over there, and we got this, and there's your answer. Are there any questions? I'd put up my hand. Is there anyone else with any questions? Well, he picked me. What is it, Michael Miro? He always called me by my full name. Michael Miro, what is it? I said, shouldn't that be 9.8 meters per second squared, Mr. McDonough? He looked back, looks at me, that's right, Michael Miro. Puts the two on there. So I was good at physics. So much better, I thought, than Mr. McDonough, I figured maybe God wanted me to be a physicist. Yeah, that's what God wants me to do, become a physicist someday in the future. Well, 10 or 12 years from now, after my training's done, I will answer my call from God by becoming a physicist later. Anyway, that year, grade 12, a lot of us turn 18, so they used to have a blood drive right there in the hallway of the school over Holy Trinity, right? Trying to donate blood. So they had these cots set up throughout the student lounge, throughout the hallway, nurses everywhere, my fellow classmates all lying there, being sucked like lemons, you know, with these great big needles in there, blip, 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 they're just lying there. Also, they can have a cookie. That was their prize, some cookie. I figured that better be some pretty good, darn good cookie. It better be Pepsi in that cookie, as far as I'm concerned, if you expect me to get me on one of those beds. And of course, which teacher do you think was put in charge of the blood drive? Mr. McDonough. As soon as he got assigned the job, first thing he said, where's Michael Miro? He wandered throughout the hallway, Michael Miro! Michael Miro! Where the heck are you, Michael Miro? I want your blood, Michael Miro! Lucky for me, I could hear him coming a mile away. Michael Miro, I sense your presence, Michael Miro. As soon as I heard him, I took off in the other direction. So I was in pretty good shape back then in grade 12, and I could fit really well inside a locker. So anyway, one day I'm standing in my English classroom. Class is about to start. I'm chatting there with my buddy Greg and a few other friends there. And I heard this voice coming from the door of the classroom right behind me. Michael Miro, don't move. I froze. Ugh, I've got you now, Michael Miro. Big grin on his face. I looked around for an escape route. There was nothing. Didn't know where I was going to do. I was trapped. He said, let's see how many meters per second squared I can suck out your blood, Michael Miro. And I said, I want my mommy. And just then, a football player came up behind him and tapped him on the shoulder. Mr. McDonough, where's my cookie? And as his back was turned, I dove under the desk and hid. He turned around again. Where did he go? I can't find, where did he go? You must be there somewhere. I hid under the desk praying, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed be thou, blessed be. And I heard him say, I smell the blood of a Frenchman, Michael Miro. Greg, which way did he go? Greg said, I think he went that way, Mr. McDonough. Oh, I'll get you. And I heard him crunching down the hall. Can't hear the feet of the tarnation. Michael Miro. And I'd escaped. Greg saved me. And that's my story. True story. The reason I tell you this story is because in a way, Jesus was a lot like Mr. McDonough. I'm not sure this is obnoxious, mind you, but a lot like him. I wanted to do God's will, right? In the future, by becoming a physicist or a cartoonist or a priest, all things that would take me at least 8 to 12 years to accomplish. But Mr. McDonough wanted what I had right then and right there. My blood. Did I answer my call? No. And ironically, it's blood that my best friend Greg probably could have used less than a year later when he had to be in the hospital. Jesus does the exact same thing with Peter and Andrew and James and John in the gospel. He doesn't come up to them and say, "Peter, I want you to be Pope." He doesn't say that. He doesn't say, "James, I want you to be bishop in Jerusalem. John, I want you to write a gospel. Andrew, I want you to start a golf course in Scotland." Doesn't do that. "So I want all of you to drop everything and become such and such and so and so 20, 30, 1500 years from now." He doesn't say anything like that. He knows that they can't do it, mostly because they'd think that they can't do it. And because the truth is, none of us are going to be able to listen to the big callings in life until we learn to listen to the little callings. So Jesus, he looks at these four guys and sees what they're already doing. Fishing. Sees they're good at it. Figures, yeah, these are exactly the kind of help I need. Because I need fishermen. Only difference is, you're going to be catching a different kind of fish using a different kind of net. And this is all Jesus is asking us today. Just as Jesus came up to these four guys while they were doing their ordinary everyday things, Jesus comes up to us today in whatever we do every day. And he's saying, what you're doing right now, plumber, grocery store clerk, electrician, farmer, teach a class, write an exam, sue someone, or pick up garbage, be a mom or a dad or a son or a daughter. Maybe you're a good listener or a hard worker or a good cook or a builder or an organizer or a friendly person. Whatever you have, whatever you're good at, whatever you do, Jesus is telling us, keep doing it. Only I want you to do it from now on for me. And that's how, actually, all of us, every one of us here, men, women, children, single, married, whatever, every single one of us are called to be priests. We are all called to the priesthood of all believers. In fact, we all agreed to be priests when we were baptized. And by that I mean everything we do is to be done for Christ. That's how, just like Peter and Andrew and James and John, we're all called to drop everything so we can change the world, create the kingdom of God. All we have to do is keep doing what we're doing, but do it for God. Keep doing what you're doing, only do it with love, because God is love. Amen.